Good morning, everyone. I know we have some virtual as well as in person for some testimony today. Good morning. I call the meeting here of, we're having an informational meeting. Have to be careful not to say an actual voting meeting. Informational meeting today on trauma-informed care. The House Children and Youth Committee is called to order. Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you very much for everyone being here. I want to say very much thank you to Chairwoman Delisio and her staff. Camilla worked hard on this meeting. When we first sat down as both new chairs to this committee, there were a lot of issues that we both felt were very, very important. And we've tried to work through a lot of hearings on them, a lot of sharing of information. One of the issues that was very important to Chairwoman Delisio was trauma-informed care. We have worked on a number of pieces of the foster system and many of the other parts of our child welfare system, but this was one that she very much wanted to handle, and we tag-teamed on that, and I appreciate her willingness to be in charge of this hearing and coordinating everybody. But to give a little bit of background with trauma, each and every child in our welfare system comes from a background, most likely, of some sort of trauma. The ability for us to understand what that trauma is sometimes is incomprehensible as to what a child may have been through. The ability for us to take a look at some of these traumas, those of us that are policymakers, time and time again, we need to stop the harm. We need to make sure we can protect as many children as we possibly can. I'll be very interested to hear a lot of the testimony today as it comes from, some of it is very science-based in the sense of surveys, of working with children. We also have some folks coming, I know, that where the rubber hits the road with the children and seeing what has happened when someone has suffered a trauma and how can we as a system better adapt to taking care of that. The purpose of intervention, whether it be foster care, congregate care, or in-home care services, is to provide a safe space and create conditions under which it'll be possible for the child to begin to heal. That requires not only an understanding of the trauma that they've experienced, but also how it will continue to affect them. As I mentioned, there's research, and there's many of those in our state that do this type of care on a regular basis with our children. We look forward to hearing from many of them as we move through the hearing, asking questions and getting their perspective. So with that, I will hand it over to Chairwoman Delisio.
Thank you and good morning. And I am very, very grateful for the support of Representative Delosier on this particular topic. It is an important topic, and for any of those who have known me either in this career in the public sector or my previous private sector career, I am a root cause person. You know, it's very important to address issues and matters that are facing us as policymakers. We do that every day, or we certainly attempt to. But at some point, we really need to step back and think about what created the situation that we're trying to remedy, and is there a way to correct that situation? What is indeed the root cause? A few years ago, I happened to be at a seminar hosted by our own Department of Health's Office of Equity, and one of the breakout sessions was on adverse childhood experiences, otherwise known as ACEs. Take this off. And was very fascinated by the score, the questions, et cetera. And this session, and serving as the minority chair, this is the opportunity to explore this further. I think many of our colleagues might find the nomenclature, the lexicon of trauma-informed care and ACEs is new to them. And even though the oversight of this committee is, in fact, the child welfare system, we all know here today, or we will definitely know beyond a doubt, that trauma-informed policy should reach into many, many aspects of what we do as a General Assembly, including the judiciary, education, come to mind very, very quickly. I know we have a lot of competition for other voting meetings this morning as well, some other hearings, et cetera, but we're very grateful for the members who are here and look forward to this morning's presentations.
And I apologize. I forgot to do introductions. And if we can start with that from the left over here, Representative Major.
Representative Abby Major, 60th Legislative District, Armstrong, Butler, and Indiana Counties.
Brian Smith, Legislative District 66, Indiana and Jefferson County.
Napoleon Nelson, 154th Legislative District in Montgomery County.
Representative Silvis, the 55th District. I have Westmoreland, Armstrong, and Indiana County.
Camilla Horst, Democratic Executive Director.
Pam DeLisio, and I represent parts of Philadelphia and Montgomery counties.
Cheryl DeLosier, and I represent Cumberland County.
Anna King, Executive Director.
Malou McKenzie, State Rep for 131st District, part of Lehigh County, part of Northampton County, and part of Montgomery County.
Wendy Thomas, Bucks County.
Nancy Gunns, Montgomery County and a portion of Philadelphia.
Ann Flood, 138th District, Northampton County.
Christine Howard, the 167th in Chester County.
Okay, and just to reiterate, we got everybody? Okay, just to reiterate, for those who may see folks coming in and out of the room, it's nothing personal, please. There's about, I believe, five or six other committee meetings happening, not only here, but also voting meetings, and I know some of our members are on some of those committees, so I just want to put that out there, because they all have your testimony, which is beneficial, so thank you for that, and with that, I'll hand it over.
Our first presenter this morning is Dr. Daniel Taylor. Dr. Taylor is a board member for the Pennsylvania chapter of the American Academy of Pediatrics. He's also the director of community pediatrics and child advocacy at St. Christopher's Hospital for Children. Dr. Taylor, it's a pleasure to have you join us this morning, and we look forward to your remarks. Dr. Taylor, can you hear us? Oh, Dr. Taylor, can you hear us? Well, now we can't hear you.
Yeah, I can hear you. I need to share.
There you go. We just did a lovely introduction. I hope you caught that. If you missed it, trust me, it was a good one. So you are up, sir.
All right. I'm trying to share a screen.
Oh. Dr. Taylor, can you hear us?
Yes. Yes, can you hear me?
Well, now we can't hear you.
I can hear you perfectly.
There you go. We just did a lovely introduction. I hope you caught that.
I caught it. Yep. I'm just trying to share.
Trust me, it was a good
one. Thank you. Well, I'm trying to share screen, if that's okay.
Dr. Taylor, can you hear us?
Yes.
Yes, can you hear me? Well, now we can't hear you.
Technology is great when it works. Come this way. Can you? Come sit next to Barb.
I can hear you perfectly. Can you hear me?
We can now. Go ahead, please.
I was trying to share a screen, but I'm not too sure if I'm allowed to or I can. May I share a PowerPoint presentation with you?
Yes.
If you can.
All righty, real quick, I'm sorry. Okay, that's all right. I'll just do a quick presentation then. And I thank you so much for this opportunity. Mrs. DeLisio described, I'll go over who I am really quickly. But the objectives of what I was invited to do was to describe the impact of trauma on the child's physical and mental health, what are the impacts of trauma in the near, mid, and long term. Let's discuss the ACEs, or Adverse Childhood Experience Test, how it's administered, and how it should be used, and why this focus, this extremely, extremely important focus that you guys are taking on, is both a moral, an equitable, but also a financial necessity. Our former American Academy of Pediatrics president, the national president, Breyer, discussed that poverty, a serious non-communicable disease that children have, and unfortunately the most common. So I'm going to discuss the potential effects of poverty on children across their lifetime. And we know that really early on in a child's life, from birth until 5 years of age, makes the biggest difference, because that's when the brain is growing so quickly. The actual head circumference of a child's brain has 80% of its growth within the first 3 years. So it's those years that are so, so, so important. I'm the medical director of what's called the Center for the Urban Child at St. Christopher's Hospital for Children in North Philadelphia. We have 21,000 kids that we care for in the outpatient setting, one of the largest practices on the East Coast. 91% of our children are on Medicaid, and 93% identify Black or Indigenous citizens of color. I also run the Medical Legal Partnership here. We have a lawyer in our practice. We have lots of other initiatives that are just so important to the children and families that we serve. I really quickly wanted to just go over one of the patients that I just saw last week, who's a JP, he's 5 years old, a speech delay, major behavioral issues. He's been kicked out of daycares. He's been hospitalized a couple times for his asthma. Mom's concerned about ADHD. He has learning issues already. Mom was a teen mom, 16, has traumatic stress disorder, and dad's away in prison. So just really quickly, we think to ourselves, what would be his ACE score and what are ACEs? And also just thinking about what's called implicit bias of JB, just kind of getting an image of who JB is in your mind. And then really, we're going to talk about trauma and resiliency trajectories across a lifelong of health. Just some quick statistics. You guys know this, unfortunately, all too well, that we are the 14th worst in the state of Pennsylvania for heart disease, heart attack, strokes, 33,000 COVID deaths just last year, cancer accidents and overdoses of 5,000 last year. There's huge social disparities here in Pennsylvania. We have 96,000 individuals in prisons or jails, which is the 14th highest in the country. 5.6% of our population receives Social Security, 6% unemployment rate, 88% on-time graduation rate throughout the state, only 80% in Philadelphia. And the teen birth rate is the 38th worst in the United States and Pennsylvania, 16 kids under 20 giving birth out of 1,000. And really quickly, we talked about poverty at the beginning. There's 2.6 million children in Pennsylvania, 25% or a quarter living in poverty. Out of those, 35% are Black, 11% are white. We have 15% of our families that are food insecure, and 15% of families with children have little or no confidence in their ability to make the next rent or mortgage payment. This is recent statistics just in the past couple months. 44% of Black families worry about that, and 10% of white families. And there's 25% of children in the welfare system. In Philadelphia, the infant mortality rate is pretty high. In Pennsylvania, 5.9 children out of 1,000 die before their first birthday, which is one of the worst in the entire world in terms of industrialized nations. Infants more than twice that. And in my community where I serve, a child born in North Philadelphia, right around St. Christopher's,
on average, if they live in the code that they're born in, they lose 20 years of life. So they die 20 years younger than somebody who lives just miles away in Society Hill or Chestnut Hill. So just briefly, trauma, since we're talking about that today, results from an event or a series of events or circumstances experienced by an individual that's potentially harmful or life-threatening with potential long-lasting effects. Unfortunately, many of our children grow up with trauma. Just really quickly, some a little bit older stats, these are the only ones I could find. 71% of children are exposed to violence every year. There's over 3 million children a year, naturally, that are maltreated or neglected, a lot witnessing violence. And 94% of those children who are in the juvenile justice setting have experienced trauma. So what makes children especially vulnerable? Children can't raise themselves. They rely on adults, who have the wherewithal to mediate experiences with them. And the younger the child, the more resilient, reliant they are on the adults, and the more, like we talked about, their brains kind of change so quickly. Maltreatment in the early ages is especially pernicious. Really vulnerable when traumatizing events are perpetrated by the caregivers, and caregivers are also symptomatic, or caregivers are unavailable or preoccupied. Just quickly going over the Average Child Experience Study. This was done back in the late 90s, Kaiser Permanente in San Diego. What it looked at is over 17,000 adults, average age of 53, and asked about their previous history of trauma, abuse, neglect, mental dysfunction, like family mental illness or substance abuse or incarceration or separation or divorce. And the study, this A study, was 70% Caucasian, 70% college educated. And what they noticed is that adults who had adverse child experiences, there was 10 of them that they studied, for every adverse child experience above zero, there was worse health outcomes. There's what's called a dose response curve, meaning if you have zero ACEs, your chance of something is this. If it's four, it's much higher, and on and on and on. So ACEs are interrelated and have this cumulative effect. It's the number of different categories of adverse child experiences that determine health outcomes. Just briefly, in pediatrics, if you had four or more adverse child experiences in pediatrics, much higher rates of adolescent pregnancy, ADHD, behavioral problems, just like in JB's case. And then as adults, if you had four or more adverse child experiences, you have a 70% higher likelihood of having heart disease, which is number one killer in Pennsylvania nationally. And also, the adverse child experiences predisposes adults. So experiences in childhood predisposes adults to 8 out of the 10 most common causes of death in Pennsylvania. And also, ACEs are huge in the classroom. They're the leading, the greatest single predictor for health attendance and behavior in the classroom are adverse child experiences. And they're the second strongest predictor after special education for academic failure. And really, when we think about the science behind early childhood adversity and what being worried and feeling like they're alone does to the developing brains and bodies, kind of change our perspective on how we think of individuals and not really thinking about what's wrong with an individual, what's really happened to them, and how their life experiences of biography, what zip code they live in, affects their biology, kind of gets in their skin. And don't forget, there's positive childhood experiences. I want to be constant on this, but there's so many positive child experiences that builds the child's sense of belonging, connection. And lots of research shows that having those positive child experiences, even with toxic stress, actually increases the potency of the child, and then they're healthier throughout their lifetime. The initial ACE study has some issues with it because it was 70% white, 70% college educated, so not really a representative study population. And it didn't really include myriad of other social influences of health, such as poverty, races, and it really focuses on deficits. Your parents are divorced, or you live with someone who has substance abuse, not really assets that are so important. It's really economically devastating. It's a moral obligation for the state to really address ACEs at an early age, but if you don't pay for it now, you pay for it much, much later. And multiple studies show that for every dollar invested, early childhood programs before the age of 5 saves the state up $6, $7, $8, even $10 later on. And there's a Nobel Prize laureate named James Heckman, who's called the Heckman curve, that showed that every dollar invested in children before age one has incredible benefits to society later on. Decreased reliance on Social Security, decreased incarceration, more likely to graduate high school, and more likely to decrease teen pregnancy. Investing early on in programs that buffer trauma, that support families, these are the things that we really need to focus on early on in life. There's some studies that show that the poverty, trauma, and toxic stress across the country, about $1 trillion a year, which is about 4% of gross domestic product. Really, this is an economic issue as well as a moral obligatory issue. One study I just wanted to point out called Baby's First Year Study that is ongoing right now. It's about a 15-year study. They've done is they just elevated impoverished families. They gave them $333, a little bit more a month versus control. It's showing on MRIs and brain scans that just having a little bit of extra money in these lower-income families so improves the actual brain on MRI in the areas of the brain that's responsible for learning and responsible for thinking before you act. So this is extremely important. We need to think about protective factors, positive childhood experiences, resiliency, and trauma-informed care. There's so much trauma. Some of those statistics have shown you that. So nurturing and attachment is so important. So we really need to focus lots of our efforts and bills on early childhood programs that support the families and communities that support those children. It's so important. Really having a safe, stable, nurturing relationship is the biggest buffer of all in terms of helping children overcome trauma or be buffered from trauma. So really focus on the mothers caring for those children, fathers and the communities caring for those children. So trauma-informed care, I just wanted to touch on, refers not only to the recognition of the pervasiveness of trauma, also to a commitment to identify and address it early whenever possible. Extremely important for everything we're talking about today. And I know other presenters here will talk about this as well. Public health approach toward trauma, adverse child experiences, is to really do it for everyone, really focus early on buffering trauma, on promoting safe, supportive, nurturing relationships for both the parent as well as the child. In my practice, I spend probably half of my time on the parent's physical, mental, spiritual health than they do on the child. That's extremely important. So we need really protective factors, concrete supports, basic needs like insecurity, security, housing insecurity, reduction of income and policy inequity, really trying to make our neighborhoods as safe as they can be, supportive family planning, on and on and on. So, so important. If you don't focus now on it, pay for it later on. So again, it's a moral, equitable, but financial issue I talked about. We wanted to talk about screening, and I'll take questions later on. We have to also be prepared for what we're doing. Some people, there was a policy lab that just came out that really didn't criticize, but just comment on the screening that we're all doing on social, the health and adverse child experiences. Because sometimes it just focuses on the basic needs right now, food, housing, utilities, important. It doesn't really focus on the programs that are actually helping families' needs, or really those sustainable social needs. We also have to be careful asking some of the very touchy, very traumatized questions that we put in a way that isn't re-traumatizing families. And also, we have to be extremely cautious because, as healthcare providers, we're documenting this stuff in a family chart. And with the 21st Century Cures Act, parents can't read what we're writing every single time. So I'm just gonna end really quickly, and then we'll take questions later on with Margaret Mead, who's an anthropologist from the 1450s, that the solution of all adult problems tomorrow depends in large measure upon the way our children grow up today. So hopefully, and I'd like to thank Representatives DeLozier, DeLisio from Roxborough, who are my favorite cheesesteak place in Philadelphia, Del Sandra's. all the time. I'd love to also thank the Pennsylvania House and Children and Youth Committee for really addressing this issue, which is true to my heart, but honestly, it should be true to every single Pennsylvania's heart, because children are our greatest asset, our most precious treasure. Thank you so much for giving me this time. I look forward to hearing everybody else's testimonies today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Taylor. I appreciate that presentation. And then we do have a couple of minutes for questions after this panel.
Yeah. Okay.
Doctor, thank you so much. This is Cheryl DeLosier. The question that I had when you were going through your descriptions was, obviously we know about when you think of severe trauma, you think of something that there's catastrophic, that someone happened. You gave an example of a situation where certainly a child had suffered many, many different types of trauma. To you and what you have seen in your practice, what would you say is the minimum that you would consider a trauma that a child could be adversely affected by it? We've talked about divorce, which certainly is not a loss of someone, certainly. It's not an imprisonment, of someone being in prison or something like that. I'm just looking for the end-to-end, if there is such a thing. What is something as, and I don't want to minimize, but what is something as very small that could still have an impact on a child? I assume it's different for every child.
Yeah, that's a great question. It is different for every child. There's what you described as what's called complex trauma, which is multiple different traumas, which has the kind of worse effects both in the short and long term. But it's honestly, and this is going to be more, it is scientifically based, and maybe DiLorenzo and others can talk about this as well. But children need a safe, supportive, nurturing relationship, somebody in their corner, because trauma really, and this is from the psychological literature, is a really scary, scary event, but feeling alone and not supported and not seen. So children who have trauma and all the traumas that you talked about, but have somebody who talks to them about it, who they feel they can go to and talk about it, who they feel will kind of take care of them with future traumatic events, those children actually do better medically throughout their life. So having that safe, supportive, nurturing relationship, safe, their own safety, secure, feeling financially secure. I left my house today and I have my car and I was thinking about this testimony and I have so much safety in my life. And that safety comes from having money, living in a safe neighborhood, having, the color of my skin and my sex, honestly. But many of our families in Pennsylvania, and especially in Philadelphia, and especially the part of Philadelphia I have, don't have that. So really focusing on the safety of families that are supporting our children, the security, and really giving them parenting classes, paid maternity leave, more investments in quality early childhood programs. But it also comes from just us as adults really understanding that, these communities, these children don't ask for this, and just being open to the conversations and not scared of them, and just, opening our hearts to really want to do what's best for that family, child, community. I don't know if that answers your question. I know I went on a little bit. But really investing in early childhood programs is by far the biggest investment we could do, both moral and financial.
Thank you. And just one quick follow-up. With you mentioned community, certainly want our families to be strong for that safe environment that you mentioned. Do you find that community organizations like a city organization at a YMCA or a community center that brings children in, that they may not get that safe, nurturing environment from their family, but the community could offer that as well? Is that better or worse or equal, just as long as it's safe and nurturing?
Yeah, it's, a lot of families, that safe, supportive, nurturing relationship is a coach. It's somebody from the PAL Center, the Boys and Girls Club. It's the aunt who lives down the street. So it's really the whole community. It's a block captain. You know, the most important is the person that lives in the home with that child and supporting them, because that's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I sometimes, and there's lots of research about after-school programs. I know the United Way is presenting later on. But, you know, in my experience, those are incredible programs, and they have such great research that comes out of it. But you have to have a family member that gets the kid there, especially at an early age. You have to have a family member who fills out the application to get them to whatever program. You really need to just completely look at the obstacles that some families have to get their kids into after-school programs, but definitely that's just one part, the out-of-school programs, we have what's called the Play Streets program here in Philadelphia in the summertime, so they can shut down streets and have camps on the street, which is so beautiful, so the families don't have to go somewhere and take their kid to camp. So just really being innovative and seeing how we can support communities and listening to the communities. We do a lot of stuff. There's a mantra, what's called the community by the community. Have to ask the community what will work, what they think will work for them. And unfortunately, many of us, including, you know, my institution, thinks with a good heart that we're doing the right thing without asking the community as much as we should. So for the community, by the community is so important.
Okay, thank you very much. I know we have a lot of tax dollars that go to a lot of programs within our communities. Head Start being one, like I said, some of the after-school programs and everything else. So it's good to hear that they have good outcomes and can help folks when they don't have it maybe at home. So thank you very much.
Great.
Want to see if any of our members have any. Nancy, Representative Gens, thank you.
I just have one quick question, Doctor. What percentage of your kids are in foster care? Because that right there can be a very traumatic experience for them.
Can the question be repeated? Sorry.
Nancy, is your mic on?
Yes.
Okay.
What percentage of your kids that you see, Doctor, are in foster care? Because that right there can be a very traumatic experience for some of them.
So I'm the medical director of the outpatient center. We have about 400 to 500 kids in foster care out of 20,000 here. So we actually have a program specifically for families in foster care. So that program has a physician or nurse practitioner, a social worker, and a nurse care coordinator, because those kids have such complex trauma, so they need as much as support. If they need reminders, they need, if they don't show up for their appointment, they need a way to get transportation. Again, if we just leave it up to sometimes families who live in such chaos to bring their kids to the doctor's office and they don't come, it's not doing anybody any good, and they're gonna be ill later on. So we have about 500 in foster care out of 20,000 that we take care of. But there's many, 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 many more that are the Child Protective Services. We're still with their families, and what we're trying to do is keep them with their families. That's our most important objective, is to support that family, understand that that family had multiple traumas when they were growing up, and really help them to heal, because we know hurt people, and need to really stop the hurt upstream before it continues families and our community.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and Dr. Taylor, I think I heard that you'll be with us the entire time, so that's great. So I'm going to hold my question for later so we can keep going here. So next person offering comments is Daniel German. He is the Executive Director of the Governor's Office of Advocacy and Reform. So Dan, are you with us?
I am. Can you hear me?
Yes, and we can see you. Very good.
Excellent. Thank you so much. I was with you in person today, and I had an injury over the weekend to my foot, and so I appreciate the ability to join you virtually. I thank the committee so much for holding this session today and for inviting me to be a part of it. This is such an important topic, as you heard from Dr. Taylor. On a personal note, I will share that I first learned about adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs, back in 2013 when I was doing anti-poverty work. And at the time, I was learning about the ACEs, survey myself on the Centers for Disease Control website, and determined that I experienced 8 out of 10 childhood traumas that the ACEs, the original ACEs survey. The biggest impact from that was the time that I spent living in poverty, as well as living in a household with domestic violence for 10 years. That led to me getting a diagnosis of complex PTSD. The impacts of the play out, it's been a long, long time since I was a child, but those impacts,
Dan, not to interrupt, it seems to be, it's kind of skipping. I don't know if it helps sometimes to turn the camera off in those situations. Not like I have tech background here, but.
Can you hear me now?
That sounds better.
Did it stop skipping?
Not so far, so maybe if we'll try it this way, please.
Very good. So I was saying I realized that I was an 8 out of 10 on the original ACEs survey, and that has had lifelong impacts for me. As a man of 51, it affects everything about my life. I'm still working through some of the challenges of what childhood trauma has done in terms of my behavioral health and also physical health. So I really appreciate the ability to highlight this on a personal note, but also through my work doing anti-poverty work. Once I started learning more and more about trauma and adverse childhood experiences, I started seeing the way the dots connected around the people that I was serving in the different communities I've served, and how this affects all sorts of community ills, from poverty to crime to substance use, you name it. In 2019, 2 years ago, almost to the day, I had the opportunity to join the governor's office in the new Office of Advocacy and Reform. And one of the things that drew me to that job was that in the executive order, the governor stated that he wanted this office to work to make Pennsylvania a trauma-informed state. And so that became job number one when I got started 2 years ago. The impacts of adverse childhood experiences have been laid out in clear research for decades now, with an ever-growing list of intersectional research adding to our knowledge every year, and sometimes it seems like every day. Technology has really advanced neurobiology and brain science and allowed us to kind of see with science what we used to only be able to observe externally in behavior. Some of the things that we know based on the science are incredibly impactful. 50% of substance use can be linked to ACEs, 78% of IV drug use, 65% of alcoholism, 52% of domestic violence, 62% of sexual assault, 58% of attempted suicides, and 50% of depression diagnoses. Over 40% of people who join violent extremist groups have 4 or more ACEs. At least 5 of the leading causes of death in the United States are connected to ACEs: heart disease, cancer, respiratory diseases, diabetes, and suicide. People with 6 or more ACEs have a life expectancy 20 years less than someone with no ACEs. And the estimated annual U.S. population economic burden of just child maltreatment, which has a huge contribution to ACEs, was $428 billion. Preventing the 5 household dysfunction ACEs early in childhood, as Dr. Taylor was sharing as well, has a huge impact on reducing abuse and neglect. And so Alaska just this year has published on a study it did. They looked at preventing the household dysfunction ACEs from pre-birth through age 5, and they found that they had over a 40% reduction in children and youth contact as a result, which means that they prevented abuse and neglect. If we want a prosperous, healthy populace, a thriving economy, and reduction in social service and healthcare costs, the most important things we can do is prevent ACEs in children and heal their parents from the ACEs they experienced themselves during their own childhoods. In late 2019, the PA Department of Health released its report on adverse childhood experiences in the Commonwealth. This is before the COVID-19 pandemic, and it's important that we recognize that at least in what I'm seeing in the data and in some of the outcomes, these things have gotten considerably worse. But half of all Pennsylvanians had at least one adverse childhood experience. Over 19% had experienced three or more, and 38% of all Pennsylvanians had experienced either physical or emotional abuse as a child. That is especially alarming when you think about the impact that data has on education. Again, as Dr. Taylor was sharing, children have a much harder time learning the more adverse childhood experiences they're going through. Essentially, by that metric, again, pre-pandemic, 8 to 10 children in every PA classroom was returning home to face some kind of abuse. Shortly after the release of that study, the Office of Advocacy and Reform began its work to make Pennsylvania a trauma-informed state. And we did that by convening a think tank of 25 diverse trauma experts from rural, suburban, and urban communities and disciplines including psychiatry, psychology, education, research, law enforcement, local government, community development, and clergy. And that was back in April of 2020. Thankfully, as the pandemic was beginning in the midst of our interviews for think tank members, this was such a geographically diverse group that we were always going to be using a virtual platform to meet, and so the pandemic did not slow down our work. We then wrote the trauma-informed PA plan and released it to the public in July of 2020. We felt the urgency for sure, not only the issue as it existed pre-pandemic, but we could recognize as well what was happening in that time because of the pandemic. We created a public-private coalition called Heal PA that stands for Healing, Empowerment, Advocacy, Learning, Prevention, and Action. And we created that coalition to implement the trauma-informed PA plan over the succeeding 10 years. We recruited Heal PA volunteers, and now there are over 200 of them across the Commonwealth. We recruited them into 13 action teams, and those teams consist of community outreach and communication, policy and legislation, development, data and evaluation, training and organizational support, education, racial and communal trauma prevention, criminal justice, poverty reduction, business involvement, child abuse prevention, and physical and behavioral health. We formed strategic alliances with 18 local trauma or ACEs coalitions across the Commonwealth, as well as with an education group called Communities of Practice, and the United Way of Pennsylvania's Resilient PA Initiative, which I'm sure you'll hear more about this morning. We also applied for and successfully were admitted into the National Governors Association ACEs Learning Collaborative. We were one of 5 states selected to participate in that learning opportunity, where we had the chance to learn from 3 exemplar states. So today, these actions have led to a series of goals that we've achieved and proposals made to prevent ACEs, as well as help those who've experienced trauma heal from it. In the midst of this work, the COVID-19 pandemic has only added to our concerns about ACEs and children's mental health and has added more urgency to our efforts. Our current list of initiatives and accomplishments, including those of some of our partner agencies, includes including the CDC-approved ACEs questions in the Youth Risk Behavior Surveillance Systems, or YRBSS, survey for the first time to better identify areas of disproportionate impact. Since not all school districts use the YRBSS, we've also been working to get the Pennsylvania Youth Survey, or PAYS, data about risk and resilience across a broader group of stakeholders so that we can better build strategies and mobilize resources together. We've also decided that we should assume that every child in Pennsylvania who was alive from March 2020 onward has experienced at least one adverse childhood experience from the intersecting traumas and unrelenting stresses of this time period. COVID-19, racial justice challenges, political unrest, overdose deaths, homicides, child abuses, there's been a lot. As one small example, the Department of Health estimated that in my home county of Lancaster alone, The pandemic has taken a parent from over 325 children so far. As a result of these widespread traumas, we are planning a universal healing strategy for 2022 that will equip teachers, pediatricians, and parents, and any other professions that are in high contact with our children, with ACEs information and resources to help the children in their orbits recover from what's happening around them and to them. OSOF and OCYF are in the process of requiring certain categories of residential facilities to become trauma aware and to put them on a trajectory to eventually become trauma informed based on the continuum that we created in OAR along with our think tank as a part of the trauma informed PA plan. The Department of Education has created several social emotional learning and trauma training modules for all Pennsylvania school districts to use at no cost. So that we can have an equal playing field across school districts around the Commonwealth. QPA and the Office of Advocacy and Reform are planning a series of community conversations on trauma, ACEs, and toxic stress with low-income and BIPOC communities in partnership with several community action agencies around the Commonwealth. These events are designed to equip and empower families to understand the forces that are impacting their lives and the resources that can help them heal. We start talking about neurobiology and some of the deep science of ACEs. It becomes really, really hard sometimes to understand everything that we're talking about when we're talking in this realm. And so we really want to bring this into plain language conversations with people so that they can understand what's happening to them. Adverse childhood experiences were an urgent concern prior to the COVID-19 pandemic. Now, in the midst of so many unrelenting traumas and chronic stresses, we face not only the challenges of a national emergency in children's mental health, but decades of negative behavioral and physical health outcomes, as well as devastating increases in substance use, violent crime, suicides, child abuse, domestic violence, and a whole host of damaging social issues if we don't act now. The science is clear. The trajectory is predictable, and we can see the beginnings of it even now. Pennsylvania has made a good start, but this moment in history demands that we do much more. We must invest in building the resilience and supporting the healing of all Pennsylvanians now, or pay the union financial price of our inaction for a generation or more. With that, I'd be happy to take any questions that you have.
Thank you, Dr. German. Representative Nelson.
Thank you, and I again also appreciate this hearing that we're able to have. I thank you both for coming and speaking to us. I guess my first question, if I could even go back to Dr. Taylor, could you help us understand a little bit about the work that was done to understand trauma as it pertained to World War veterans, so that when we think about ACEs and adverse childhood experiences, we can make sure that we're appreciating just the physical and psychological impacts that aren't just on children, but understanding its roots in how we consider and care for even our war veterans.
That's a question for me.
If whichever of you would be best able to address it and just help lay that foundation.
I think we have to, I'll briefly just answer, you know, the trauma is just, there's so much trauma. If a person comes back from battle, from war, whether it's war overseas or whether it's war within their own community, if they don't have their own healing and access to healing, it will 100% affect, you know, the child that they're trying to connect with, care for, and love. So we do also screening. We look at returning war veterans and giving resources for families who have people either overseas or coming back, just like we give resources to children who have returning citizens from prisons and jails. Both of those are extremely important in terms of addressing both veterans as well as, you know, people coming back from even incarceration here in the United States.
And I guess the reason I posed that first question was just to talk a little bit about the fact that the trauma that we are talking about now that children are realizing through adverse childhood experiences, the trauma itself is not unique to children. And in fact, we understood it not from studying poverty, but in fact also from studying veterans and its impacts psychologically and physiologically. So the reason I say that is we think about adverse childhood experiences and looking at these kind of 12 items, and we can all argue that there should be a few other items that would present as traumatic experiences for children that aren't part of this model of 12. But the role of adverse childhood experiences in this model is really to be able to understand a little bit more what children might be wrestling with, what experiences might be causing trauma in folks who aren't really great at expressing their difficulties in their society, and making sure that we can then wrap them in supports, correct? So we're not looking at these 12 items that are adverse childhood experiences and automatically assuming that they are traumatic. We look at them, I believe, and correct me if I'm wrong, we look at them as signs that there might be trauma happening, investigate. Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct. And there has been lots of research. Can you hear me? There's been lots of research that shows like a child who has a traumatic experience but has a safe, supportive, nurturing relationship in their life actually have better health outcomes than even a child who doesn't have much trauma but has no safe, supportive, nurturing relationship in their life. So it's that focus early on the parent that's caring for the child as well as the community, because if the community is not safe, not supportive, then the parent can't feel safe and supportive. So correct. Definitely the PTSD, the problem with a lot of our communities, it's not post-traumatic stress disorder. It's continuous traumatic stress disorder. It's every day. It's every moment. And just trying to reduce those traumas, those everyday traumas, as much as we can is so important.
And so I appreciate that. My last question will then be to Dr. German, right? So if we're understanding trauma as it's not just for children, it's not just, we're not just looking at precursors to, but what we're trying to appreciate is what children in our commonwealth might really be wrestling with, an indicator that would lead to heightened physiological or sociological distress, both currently and off into the future. I appreciate the efforts that the OAR has put forth, but I mean, it's kind of a leading question. Are we doing enough? Is there enough support and interagency supports that are available to ensure that we're actually wrapping these children in the service and supports that they need to be the productive adults in society?
Yeah, I think both Daniels will probably agree. I'll do it really quick. Definitely not enough support. We're talking about $1 trillion a year in lost GDP for untreated trauma. So definitely not enough support. Daniel?
Yes, we do agree. And I think that, for instance, one of the things in our Common Film PA plan, one of the recommendations is to advocate for living wages because of the chronic stresses that creates. And that ties to what Dr. Taylor was saying earlier about those unrelenting stresses that come with living below the poverty line. There are a lot of things that we can do to alleviate what families are going through. The majority of families that I've served throughout my career doing anti-poverty work were families that struggled with childcare. So our ability to help parents get to those living wage jobs, can be incredibly impactful and can lower our costs on the other side of this in terms of social service needs. But to your point as well, this is not just about children. And what we've seen throughout this pandemic is the emerging behavioral health crisis we're seeing with adults, which ties into what's happening with our workforce. the stresses that especially frontline service members are seeing, our hospitals, our EMTs. You know, there's a lot of trauma going on right now within our adult populations as well. And so the more we can do to help bring down the temperature for those folks and to give them the tools to de-stress and to heal from some of the things that they're experiencing is also going to be very important as we do this work.
Thank you both.
Rep. Thomas.
So my question is, from the testimony, what I'm understanding is, you know, we knew this was a problem pre-pandemic, and it's somehow amplified with everything that's been brought up. So as we sit here at the end of 2021, what should we be doing differently? I guess mainly what I'm hearing is we need more of what we're currently doing, but have we looked at what we should be doing differently to address this in a post pandemic world or as we move forward? Thank you.
I think there are two different pieces to that. In terms of the people that we serve, it becomes incredibly important to make sure that we are not re-traumatizing people with the services that we provide, that those services are delivered through a trauma-informed lens, so that we are really focusing on helping people heal. One great example of that that was approved in last year's budget was a pilot that we're now doing with OCYF in three counties, where we are working to reduce child removal from the home based on inadequate housing or homelessness. When we remove a child because of a financial issue like inadequate housing or homelessness, we're re-traumatizing the entire family as opposed to getting to the core issue, which is helping that family find sustainable, safe housing. And so that pilot is focused on doing the work in a different way, working smarter, which also, in addition to reducing trauma, should save us money, which is, you know, so we can win in multiple ways if we change the paradigm of how we deliver the existing programs that we have. I think it's also important to think about what's happening to us as the caregivers. This is called vicarious or secondary trauma. What's happening to our social workers, our nurses, our doctors, those traumas as well. How are we enhancing wellness programs, encouraging insurance companies to put more offerings on the table around behavioral health and the parity between behavioral and physical health? We have to ramp up what we're doing to help people heal, not just the people we serve and our constituents in the Commonwealth, but also the folks that are serving them.
I'm very glad to hear that. I think I think we need to support everyone with resiliency skills as an addition to the behavior health. But thank you very much. That was good information. I appreciate it.
And that was a great segue, thank you, Rep. Thomas, into our next presenter from the United Way of Pennsylvania here in person. Kristen Rotz, president of United Way of Pennsylvania, accompanied by Beth Tomlinson, the senior director of education, United Way of Greater Lehigh Valley, and co-founder of Resilient PA. Ladies, welcome, and we look forward to your comments. If you'll just make sure your microphones are on and are close to you so all can hear.
Okay. Good morning. Good morning, Chairwoman DeLisio and Chairwoman DeLosier. Thanks for the opportunity to be here to talk about trauma-informed care today. I'd also like my colleague to go ahead and introduce herself.
Morning, everyone. I'm Beth Tomlinson, Senior Director of Education at the United Way of Greater Lehigh Valley.
So the good news is that we're coming to you to bring you some community perspective on trauma-informed care, and you're going to hear a lot of mutually reinforcing themes from our clinical experts who previously testified, as well as from United Way. To start off with some background on United Way of Pennsylvania, we are a 501c3 membership organization, which represents United Ways across the state. There are 51 United Ways in Pennsylvania. They're raising roughly $170 million that they invest back in their communities. So they, outside of government, are one of the biggest sources of support for human services in our communities. We really see our mission as a state organization to help lead our network to champion financially thriving and resilient families. And we've spent a lot of our history as United Way focused on root cause solutions, just as you talked about at the beginning of the hearing. And so a lot more energy and attention is turning towards trauma, the impacts of trauma, and trauma-informed care, as well as resiliency in our communities. We have been longtime advocates for more investments in early childhood services for all of the clinical reasons you heard about child growth and brain development from birth to age 5. We know that programs like home visiting and nurse family partnership and Head Start and high quality pre-K and high quality child care all give those important foundations, which do cost some public funding up front. There's not enough philanthropic funds to meet all of those needs in Pennsylvania, but in the long run, they generate a cost savings. And so as we look at trauma, this is another example of an area where if we work intentionally and we make the right investments, we believe that we can bend the trajectory in a positive direction, both from the standpoint of health outcomes as well as public solutions and investments and costs over the long term. So that's why a lot of United Ways are starting to focus more on trauma-informed care and adverse childhood events. You've heard about how adverse childhood events can be some of the biggest stresses that children ever experience in their life. You've also heard how positive and supporting relationships with an adult can help them overcome that trauma. So United Ways make investments in things like youth mentorship programs, which help do that very thing. They help turn the tide. But we have to acknowledge that prolonged and sustained stresses of poverty, of violence in the home, of potential substance abuse or mental illness in the home, all definitely have an impact. So as we build community coalitions across the state, we are focused on how we bring all the right players to the table to start to work at a community level, to focus not only on how do we intervene when there has been trauma, but how do we support families and support individuals to recognize their own trauma and support their own resiliency as much as they can. So we believe there's a two-pronged solution here, which does require a lot of formal, clinical, and professional intervention in some cases. And in other cases, it's a matter of helping to educate our community members about how they themselves can support their own family's resiliency. So for us, trauma-informed care is about building an understanding of trauma into systems and organizations so that people serving systems can do that work and help people flourish. And I think it was mentioned earlier by Representative Delisio, but we have to recognize that trauma can come home to influence the outcomes of all different types of services. We think especially about education and children and youth first, I believe, but we also have to think about our judiciary system and our criminal justice system, where certainly there are also impacts of trauma from adults who have experienced hurt and who have not healed. So we have to look across all systems. We need unlikely allies, and in the communities where these coalitions are launching, partners are certainly finding unlikely allies who are willing to champion this idea. We're also seeing that businesses are starting to tune in to the impacts of trauma as well, because businesses are starting to realize that trauma has an impact both on the safety and the productivity of their workplaces. So we need to recognize the signs and the symptoms of trauma, but then respond by fully integrating our knowledge about trauma into policies, procedures, and practices, while also actively seeking to resist re-traumatization. I also want to point out the theme of inclusivity in these conversations. It is important that diverse voices are heard. Everyone who has a different background has a different experience with trauma. And so historically, policies have been legislated from a place of control, which is very white-centered and male-centered in its power structure. As we look to build solutions for trauma, we need to bring in more diverse voices, different races and ethnicities, different gender identities, different sexual orientation, and different ability levels to help build a strategy that works for all Pennsylvanians. So this year, United Way of Pennsylvania launched something called Resilient PA. Resilient PA is a statewide grassroots network which strives to foster resilient youth, families, and communities through promoting trauma-informed care and systems across sectors. We are also working to promote efforts to reduce risk factors and increase protective factors for youth and families to break cycles of family and community trauma. Our statewide coalition is really a platform to connect local communities and local leaders who want to work on the issue of trauma-informed care, best practice, and promising practices that can help all of us improve outcomes. And we're looking at health outcomes as well as economic outcomes being impacted by trauma-informed care. So we have a statewide network of trauma-informed champions who are coming together and learning from each other. And over the course of this year, we have held three specific events which are designed to do this. You can think of us as kind of the grassroots community complement to Heal PA, which you heard about earlier. And we are actually working very closely with Heal PA. We're really excited about all of the experts who have been brought to that table. They're going to be generating a lot of good information that we want to share out to communities. So we have intentionally built a website platform, which is supporting both Heal PA and Resilient PA, and will allow us to share information back and forth between community and experts as well. So this is an initiative that is rather new, but we are looking forward to the connectivity, and we are also committed to giving this work sort of a home and to be advocates as we move forward and make sure that we can keep this issue in front of all of you as policymakers. We also have a couple of local partners who are not with us today, but have been taking major leadership roles on trauma-informed care. They each submitted some written testimony for you if you'd like to read more about that. Specifically, we're talking about United Way of Erie County and United Way of Greater Philadelphia and Southern New Jersey. So if those are in your districts, I would encourage you to take a look at their extra written testimony. But in the case of United Way of Erie County, they are working with the Erie Coalition for a Trauma-Informed Community to champion trauma-informed practices at a growing number of community schools throughout Erie. This coalition was founded to create a bridge to healing by building a supportive, connective community dedicated to enhancing resiliency and reducing the impact of trauma. It is comprised of citizens from throughout Erie County, as well as individuals representing faith-based organizations, service providers, businesses, schools, person-serving systems, and community centers. So there you can hear some of that diversity in coalition, people coming together to tackle similar challenges. And then at the United Way of Greater Philadelphia and Southern New Jersey, they've been doing work in the trauma-informed care space for a while, starting with some support from the Thomas Scattergood Behavioral Health Foundation and the Philanthropy Network of Greater Philadelphia, which launched Trauma-Informed Philanthropy as a guide that highlights best practices in leveraging resources and relationships to advance trauma-informed practice and move from knowledge to action. The United Way of Greater Philadelphia and Southern New Jersey also partnered with the Lakeside Global Institute, which is one of the preeminent leading organizations on trauma-informed training. They worked with Lakeside to develop and deploy and scale a systematic trauma training program, which they've been delivering to all different kinds of audiences. That includes parents and advocates. It also includes early childhood educators and behavioral health specialists. And that's to provide the resources and tools necessary to understand trauma. But another component of that is recognition and understanding of the impacts of trauma. Some people call it vicarious trauma, the trauma that people who work with children who have experienced trauma will just experience on their own because of exposure to the child's circumstances with their own trauma. So those are all important elements of how our people-serving systems need to be supported to address this work going forward. And I'd like to turn it over now to Beth Tomlinson, who will talk about a very comprehensive effort in the Greater Lehigh Valley, which is also connected to community schools.
Morning, everyone. Is that good? Yeah, so I think I'm going to be providing a little bit more kind of context of how our Lehigh Valley community is really not only promoting healing, but trauma-informed care. So our United Way serves Lehigh, Northampton, and more recently Carbon counties. And we're a 501c3 philanthropic organization that assesses community needs, raises funds, invests in community solutions, and really mobilizes the community around action and measuring results. Our United Way resources are committed to improving school outcomes for at-risk youth, ensuring older adults are safe and supported, and that struggling families have food security, and that our basic safety net systems are strong. For about 16 years, our United Way of Greater Lehigh Valley has been leading a regional community school network. And if you're not familiar with community schools, I suspect many of you are familiar with community schools, given the name of this committee. But with a community school, it's really investing in community school staffing, in addition to wraparound services like family case management, after-school programs, mentoring, tutoring, all different types of things, you know, like a food pantry, a clothing closet, really helping to connect families with any of the basic needs services that they need. So we've been leading that community school effort in our community for about 16 years. And it was really in 2015, after so many years of investing in community schools, we really started to wonder, many pieces of the community school model were working, but we weren't quite seeing that whole school improvement in attendance, behavior, and academics that we expected to see. And so we started digging a little deeper, and that was really our kind of aha moment around ACEs and childhood trauma. Both with the children coming into the schools, but also with the staff themselves, right? We have higher rates of ACEs in helping sectors. I myself am a social worker, so I can attest to that. And so we really kind of had that aha moment of kind of root cause, as you were speaking to earlier, in some of our poor school outcomes was really exposure of ACEs and the prevalence of ACEs in our schools. So we really, in 2015, started to do some awareness raising, started to mobilize some partners around this, and convened a small coalition of key constituents from education, health, behavioral health, human services, and county government, really with a sole purpose of raising awareness amongst our educators of the impact of trauma, signs and symptoms of trauma, and what a trauma-informed school would look like. And then in 2018, our cross-sector coalition had really grown significantly, as has the scope. We really started just with promoting trauma-informed schools, and then we pretty quickly realized from a youth and family perspective, yes, we need trauma-informed schools, but not just trauma-informed schools, because our youth and families intersect with all sectors. So we really broadened the mission really from just promoting trauma-informed schools to really creating a trauma-informed, resilient Lehigh Valley across all sectors and systems in our community. And with that, we were really driving to improved outcomes in education, health, human service, social services, and really promoting healing and trauma-informed and culture-responsive practices, really across systems. So we started with about 12 members and our small coalition, and today we have close to 1,000 members and growing on the daily. And our United Way acts as the backbone organization for Resilient Lehigh Valley. We started off as the Lehigh Valley Trauma Awareness Collaborative, which is a bit of a mouthful, and now we rebranded ourselves to Resilient Lehigh Valley. And in this role as backbone for Resilient Lehigh Valley, our United Way provides dedicated staff resources to convene partners, promote and host trainings and events, raise funds, track and analyze community data and impact data, raise levels of awareness on trauma in our community, and conduct outreach in the community to recruit new partners and allies. Our United Way also acts as the fiscal agent for Resilient Lehigh Valley, hosts and manages the Resilient Lehigh Valley website, social media platforms, develops and distributes a quarterly digital newsletter, and hosts an annual Building Resilient Communities conference, where we have about 300 to 500 people attend. Resilient Lehigh Valley is dedicated to promoting youth resiliency in the Lehigh Valley through creating trauma-informed and culture-responsive systems by raising awareness on trauma and ACEs, providing trainings on trauma-informed and culturally responsive practices, encouraging schools and organizations to adopt a trauma-informed and healing-centered approach, breaking down silos, and increasing collaboration and resource sharing across systems and sectors, acting as a clearinghouse for trauma and resiliency, and advocating for funding and legislation to promote trauma-informed care and healing-centered practices. Our Resilient Lehigh Valley membership includes both public and private school districts, higher education institutions, early childhood providers, health networks, behavioral health providers, county departments of human services, youth program providers like our Boys and Girls Clubs and our Ys that we talked about earlier, our housing providers, intermediate units 20 and 21, who are key trainers for us, police chiefs, local legislators, elected officials, community organizing entities, community activists, faith partners, and community members. So a very diverse set of constituents that are really helping to lead and drive this work. To date, Resilient Lehigh Valley has trained over 10,000 parents and professionals in adverse childhood experiences and trauma-informed practices. We train dedicated teams within both intermediate units 20 and 21 in trauma-informed care and trauma-informed schools so that they could be a free and sustainable trauma-informed school training entity in our community. And they've trained, I think, about 6,000 educators since we've gotten them trained. And again, that's free training that they can scale out. We conduct a regional trauma-informed school assessment to assess stages of trauma-informed school development and buy-in to then connect with our intermediate units to really target training and outreach to get more buy-in and to go deeper in trauma-informed school practices. We've also trained a dedicated team within both Lehigh and Northampton County Departments of Human Services who are trained as trainers to then train their county peers and then work with county leadership to really plan for an organizational, trauma-informed organizational and healing-centered organizational approach within both counties. When the COVID pandemic hit our region and schools were closed, our existing Resilient Lehigh Valley Coalition infrastructure really allowed us to quickly mobilize in support of our youth, families, schools, and service providers. Because schools and child care centers were closed and both are top referral sources around child maltreatment, we worried about the safety of our youth and launched a child abuse and neglect public awareness campaign targeting frontline workers, parents, neighbors, and educators. We held a year-long series of virtual trainings for educators and service providers on recognizing signs of trauma in youth, trauma-informed practices, secondary and vicarious trauma, self-care, resiliency, and more. Additionally, in partnership with Lehigh University, who's our big institution in Lehigh Valley, Intermediates 20 and 21, Shanti Project, which is one of our mindfulness providers, and Wildlands Conservancy, which focuses on nature and animals, we developed Creating Calm Together, which is a free social emotional learning and emotional regulation coping skill lesson plan guide toolkit. So videos with like animals and little kids, kindness, really talking through all the different social emotional skills to really promote calming and really help address some of that youth anxiety and family anxiety and depression rates that were escalating that we've talked about earlier and Dan spoke so well about. We also launched a Facebook Live series specifically for parents, knowing most of our parents, including our Allentown, Bethlehem, Easton parents, which are our three higher concentrations of poverty communities, are on Facebook. So we created quick videos to speak directly to parents on Facebook, really to equip them with skills, coping skills, how to recognize, for example, how to recognize signs of mental illness or mental health, depression, anxiety in their youth, similarly recognizing signs of substance abuse and what to do and how to respond, and a variety of other really important parenting skills during this really tough time. And lastly, for families, we developed and distributed calming kits for both families at home and also for students in school with really emotional regulation materials, manipulatives, links to videos as well, and some real clear guides on how to use those resources. Last year, we also launched the Handle with Care program, which many of you might know about. It might be new for some. Handle with Care is a simple communication program between law enforcement and our schools. So when students are out and about, when officers are out and about doing what they do, called to a scene and children are present, likely what called them there is something that would be traumatic or could be traumatic for children. And traditionally, children show up to school the next day. School has no idea, right? If something happens in the home or the community, the school has no idea unless the child discloses that. And usually, traditionally, the school finds out about the preceding incident that maybe caused some disruptive behavior well after something's already happened. So this is preventative, proactive in communication, where when officers are there and school-aged children are present, they simply send a hand with care referral. That referral goes through the school's safe to say system. So we specifically built that's the hand with care portal in the P3 system to connect directly into safe to say. So it shows up before the child shows up to school the next morning as a hand with care event, like self-harming or some of the other typical safe to say referrals. We built that program in partnership and collaboration with our schools and our law enforcement. Law enforcement's been really, really supportive of this. We have about 40 police departments in our community on board with it, and about 22 school districts as well. Last year was our pilot year. We had about 226 handle with care referrals, year one pilot launch. During a pandemic, right, when schools were hybrid or virtual, which was interesting. In this quarter alone, so just first quarter, September through November, we've had 176 or 178 handle with care referrals, right? So that's partly more officers are aware of this program and make the referrals, which is great. And also likely more things are happening in school and community, which I'm sure all the educators you speak to, you're probably hearing a little bit of that already. So we're hearing already more issues in happening in community there than rolling into school, and what's happening in schools rolling back out in community. So the increase in referrals probably is both more buy-in with officers and also likely more traumatic events happening in community. We've also developed hand with care training materials and videos, tip sheets for both educators and also law enforcement that's available on our website for any community to use. Since we piloted hand with care, I think about five or six other counties in Pennsylvania have begun this pilot. We did intentionally build it in a way that it could easily be scaled up and replicated. It only costs about $1,500 per county to participate in this program the way we built it. So a very very practical approach that could support students. And a key piece of hand with care, there are three key prongs: the referrals from law enforcement, which is that early heads up, the school, being a trauma-informed school and really knowing how to recognize the signs and symptoms and connect a child with supports, and then connecting the child with mental health services if and when needed. Not always needed, but if and when needed. And then just lastly, securing the funding needed to sustain and grow this work is challenging. Much of our current Resilient Lehigh Valley marketing and communications work, as well as the initial funding to lift up the Hand with Care pilot, started with a PCCD grant that we got, which ends this June. Additionally, we cannot keep up with the demand for trainings with our current staff of two AmeriCorps VISTAs, which stands for Volunteers in Service to America. It's basically a year of service that they're giving our United Way, and about half of my time. With funding to support community-based coalitions like Resilient Lehigh Valley would be greatly appreciated and would allow us to have an even greater impact in promoting healing and resiliency with our youth, families, schools, and service providers. And on behalf of the United Way of Greater Lehigh Valley and all of our members with Resilient Lehigh Valley, I just really want to thank you for this opportunity today.
Thank you both, Beth and Kristen. Question? Go ahead. Rep. DeLozier.
Thank you. You answered a few of mine. What are the five or six counties that are doing it? Do you know offhand?
Lancaster is definitely doing it. Carbon is piloting it. Montgomery and Chester are interested in it. We met with them. We actually met with Philadelphia County also. I think somebody's... Partly Philadelphia. So Philadelphia, we spoke to some folks there as well. Okay. And then Monroe and Park, we met with them, and they're looking at it as well. And then there are some counties that I'm less familiar with. There are about two or three more rural counties that are on the other side of Pennsylvania.
Well, that was actually my question, yeah, was to see what with Philadelphia a more urban setting, or is it a Carbon County or Butler County, or, you know, or my county, Cumberland County, which is actually suburban, you know, in most of, in half of it, and then very rural in the other half. So I was curious as to which ones. And you'd also mentioned about the fact that you've been doing this type of programming with trauma-informed care for about 14 years, you had made mention.
Since about 2015.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Oh, less than that.
Community schools we've been doing for 16 years.
Okay. And you mentioned other testimonies coming in from other United Ways. Is there, have you seen where, I feel like there's gaps as to, you might be doing a great job and it sounds like your programming is fantastic and very spot on the issue. How many others are like you out there in our state?
Well, I think I know Rob Ree with the Attorney General's office has been doing a lot of outreach to different counties. So I think, I forget what his numbers are, but most PA counties are doing something in this trauma-informed coalition. It might be United Way leading it, might be a higher ed leading it, it might be a county department leading it.
Which and is I fine. I don't care who's leading it as long as someone is. Yeah. And that's why I'm just curious as to where are there some gaps? Are there some, is it the rural areas that are less inclined to do it versus an urban, or is it the opposite? You know, and I'm just curious as to kind of taking a look at some of those counties and figuring out where there are gaps and maybe why. Did you see dollars coming through with the CARES funding and everything else? How did that help? You mentioned PCCD grant, which there's a lot of help comes through PCCD. And I sit on the board and see a lot of those grants going to very, very good programming. But with the most recent funding from the federal government, were you able to receive dollars that went to this type of programming or just other parts of United Way, other services? Because obviously you have a vast.
We haven't seen really at a statewide level any material impact from the federal dollars on this issue of trauma-informed care.
Okay. It has hit other topics or other types of services that you've provided. Okay. And one last question, I'm sorry. You had mentioned the train the trainer and the homeschool. So those are my two things. With the issue of home versus school and the knowledge of a traumatic issue, we actually had a hearing on that in the Southeast because of it so being so very important for if a trauma happens at home, then that child does go to school the next day and something happens. That handle with care, is that also spotty across the state, or how many others, or was that the five or six counties? I'm trying to. You mentioned a lot of programs. I was trying to keep track which one was which.
Handle with care. So we built it into the portal so the referrals can go into the safe to say system.
Is that statewide or is that just for you guys?
It can be scaled up. We built it so it can be replicated statewide.
And those are the five or six counties.
Yes.
That were,
so okay. Since we started that, five or six other counties, and we just did a couple statewide presentations on handle with care specifically. So
great.
We.
Because that was one of our subjects.
So that it could be a statewide thing if there was interest.
Because there was a lot of law enforcement with that at that hearing that mentioned the fact of where's that line that they can't tell anyone, but yet they know the child obviously have seen something the night before that could be very, very painful for them and letting the school know, but they can't cross that line. So it was interesting to hear about that handle with care because that might solve some of those issues.
Yeah, and specifically, we also built this with our district attorneys. So we have DA Martin and DA Halk in Lehigh and Northampton County. And we built it how the referral, what information gets shared with our district attorneys so we wouldn't violate that.
Right.
So the handle with care referral doesn't have any details.
Okay.
It's really just then you're putting in the name of the child, there's a drop-down menu with the school, and that's it.
Okay.
And then we train the school that when they receive that handle with care referral, what it means, and that they don't need to know the details.
Okay.
Right? They're looking for the signs and symptoms, and based on the child's symptomology, they're connecting the child with different resources. And some of that might just be, you know, an extra focus on the mentoring relationship, you know what I mean, that day.
Sure. No, I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Just a quick follow-up question for Kristen. When you said some of the federal dollars coming into the state that are COVID-related have not been deployed in such a way to have or in any way to have a statewide impact in this particular arena, is that because we as the state have yet to do that, that the opportunity is there, but the opportunity still remains to be leveraged?
Yeah, I think the opportunity definitely remains to be leveraged. We have seen some focus on building relationships with local governments as well to try to access those resources, but there's been a fairly tight interpretation of how these federal funds can be used, and some reticence to branch out to, into areas like this that would probably be a more creative use of the funds. So it is mostly about an opportunity that I think is yet to be leveraged. And there's plenty of good ways that we could see more public resources invested to support trauma-informed systems.
Well, and I, you know, it is, and I'm hoping this is what we hope that this informational meeting does, is raise this awareness so that it this is contributing to that conversation. You know, I participate in a lot of civic meetings back home, et cetera, as I'm sure we all do. And you just see behaviors we haven't seen historically. Particularly driving behaviors are one that are very evident to all of us. Everything from just if it's a traffic rule, it doesn't apply. I think this is all. I want to live long enough to read the research that talks about the era where we are living through and the impact on it in the near term, midterm, and long term. So are there any other questions for either of these commenters? Representative Nelson.
So you mentioned as part of the work that you all were doing in Lehigh Valley, working through barriers, and particularly interagency barriers. I've heard about and do appreciate the Handle With Care program. We talked a little bit about how law enforcement sometimes is not able to share more information that could be useful. Do you believe that the Handle With Care is built the way it is because of the barriers that exist? Or do you believe the Handle With Care alert is really the most and the optimal information for a school district to receive? My personal belief and bias, as we'll talk about bias, is that perhaps there is more information that could and should be shared so that school districts and other agencies are able to appropriately respond to trauma. But I'm really interested in your testimony and what you have found regarding those barriers and whether we can break those down here.
That's a great question, and it gets to kind of the heart of where we are with our Handle With Care pilot. We have a lot of educators that want more information, and we have some law enforcement officers that would like to give more information, and we have debated that exact question of should we give more with still respecting confidentiality laws. And it's been suggested, could we build into the Handle With Care portal like a tiering of trauma, like your big T, your little T trauma, right? And we've debated that really, really hard with like probably 100 educators and law enforcement officers as well. And I'll just speak for where we settled in our community, and I don't want to speak for another community. And I think both Dan's spoke to this earlier. You don't know how a child, you know, trauma is about how an individual experiences it, right? And you don't necessarily know those protective factors around that can help buffer. So we feared if officers gave details, that schools might overreact and maybe re-traumatize the child. A big piece of Handle With Care is the educator does not say, what happened last night, right? And educators at the court, they want to know. And they have good intent in wanting to know all the details because they think they need to know all the details to be able to better help a child. But the reality is it's relationship that heals, right? So you just have to focus on the relationship. You don't need the details to focus on the relationship. So there was fear that it might lead to, you know, maybe educators re-traumatizing the child with, you know, talking about those details. There was also fear that if those details didn't seem serious enough to the educator, you know what I mean? They might be like, I don't really have to do anything different with that kid, right? And the reality is if you just have that Handle With Care notice without any details, it has you looking. like objectively looking for signs and symptoms, really being more intentional with the relationship with that child. You know what I mean? And so we settled on not disclosing any details for those reasons and feel pretty good about that. But other communities, you know what I mean, might decide differently. And the Handle with Care portal could be dealt. So you could add in additional questions to the portal that it's easy to customize if communities wanted them.
Well, thank you for that. I want to be very cognizant of time. We have two more presenters. So, ladies, thank you. Much appreciated. I want to call up our next in-person presenter, Paul DiLorenzo. Paul is a consultant, a national child welfare consultant, and a senior fellow for the Child Welfare League of America. Mr. DiLorenzo, thank you for joining us this morning.
Okay. All righty. Well, good to see you all. And just so you know, I'm from Montgomery County and glad to be here. My name is Paul DiLorenzo, and I have a four-decade history in child welfare and youth development programs. During that time, I've served in both state and city government, led national systems improvement projects, and been a consultant to many states and nonprofit child welfare agencies around the country. Currently, I'm still consulting on several projects, including one with the Pennsylvania Department of Human Services. I'm also a senior fellow for the Child Welfare League of America, and let me add that I began my career as a social worker in Philadelphia. I want to thank you for this opportunity to testify and commend you on your willingness to take on the complex, enduring, and stubborn challenges related to child welfare and well-being. You've asked me to comment on to what extent trauma plays a role in the lives of children and families, especially those in the child welfare system. Given the amount of time we have here today, I will only provide a few brief observations, and then we'll encourage your questions after my testimony. The most significant levels of trauma occur in waves, not only for children, but for their entire family system. And we can't discuss any issues related to child safety and well-being without discussing the role of their families and their communities. Since most of the children who enter into the system are disproportionately poor and children of color, they carry the weight of community trauma even before we meet them. More specifically, this means dismal well-being outcomes in most spheres of their lives. In addition, most of the families who pass through the doorway of the child welfare system are experiencing parental substance use, mental health or domestic violence issues, all of which are highly traumatic for children. The overwhelming number of reports to the child welfare system are for neglect, not serious abuse. It's very difficult to discuss these cases of neglect without significant attention to poverty and the family's stress associated with meeting basic needs. In other words, it's difficult to isolate one source of trauma. Once these children and their families have contact with the system, they experience a whole other level of trauma if they are removed from their homes, their communities, and anything else with which they are familiar. But you already know all this, none of what I've said here today is new. The clients served by the child welfare system are well known and simultaneously anonymous on many levels. Our habit of removing so many children from their families is also well documented, along with the substantial research that documents how harmful separation can be over the long term. You know this because you've heard the stories many times before. Our current system resembles a hamster wheel. Depending on the day of the week, not much changes. The data ebbs and flows, but each year we remain stuck in a system that's self-perpetuating. Our sincere desire is to do our best on behalf of kids and families, and yet the outcomes remain mixed at best. I know social workers who are doing heroic things in their everyday routines, but they find themselves with little reward and a degree of progress that can only be described as glacial. With a great amount of humility, I'd like to add a few observations that might contain fresh information for you. Let's recount exactly what isn't working for the families and the public that we are charged with serving. The most obvious issue is that we are meeting families too late, when they are already at a crisis point. The research tells us that they have reached a threshold several times before the system responds in an effective manner. But by then, the intervention is quite dramatic and generally includes family separation. Take a moment to think about the multiple levels of trauma for children that occur during that period. There's a revolving door for parents as well, in large part because child protective service agencies do not have all that is needed for families. How can one agency or one caseworker be expected to address the multiple issues facing a family? No single factor drove that family to the front door of the CPS agency. So why should we imagine that a single-track response will be effective? In many Pennsylvania counties, we are still seeing a fragmentation and a lack of coordination among agencies. If this continues, so will the opportunities for re-traumatizing children. Our current practices, based largely on coercion and unrealistic expectations of families, reinforce parental resistance. They increase the level of shame and the decreased self-esteem and undermine the family's sense of competence. Our child welfare operates in a vertical direction of decision-making. If we want to strengthen families, we need practices that encourage more family engagement and collaborative decision-making. Finally, and related to all of what I've just noted, we continue to have counties where there is little formal interaction planning between the primary systems: drug and alcohol, mental health, education, and domestic violence. Lacking that coordination, kids and families continue to be caught in a cycle of trauma, harm, and failure. Trauma implies repetition and the reinforcement of behaviors that leave an individual or a family or a community feeling hopeless. Such is the conditioning of the children and families who inhabit the child welfare system. The evidence is seen in the disproportionate number of parents who themselves were in the system as children. But if we want children to be safe and stable, and eventually self-sufficient, they need strong, engaged families and communities that support family life. Government programs cannot and should not exist to take the place of a family or to raise children. We should be there to assure the safety of children and to clear the path so that parents can do the best job possible. The trauma of repetition, of over-promising, along with our transactional model of delivering services and supports to families, is why few families trust us. The trauma of multiple staff turnovers also leaves its mark. And for families, it is the trauma of having no control and little voice in what happens. We fail to fully appreciate the intergenerational nature of the issues facing these families. From day one of carrying a caseload, I was shocked to learn how many parents were yesterday's children. The multidimensional nature of their problems and the enduring unresolved trauma translates to an unfair starting point when they begin having kids of their own. And because of their histories, these parents see the agencies as underachievers when they need help and overreaching when it comes to being overly directive. This is the trauma of a classic no-win situation. So enough with the challenges. Allow me to address how we might consider transforming our systems. If we're really truly committed to developing a trauma-informed system, we need to uphold certain values. Among them are a relentless commitment to child safety, stability, and well-being. 2, a relentless commitment to strengthening families as the primary caregivers of children and supporting the communities in which they live. Honesty and transparency on the part of all of us who work in this system. A relentless commitment to quality and excellence. A relentless commitment to parent engagement, choice, and empowerment. Cultural, linguistic, and historical competence on the part of professionals who support families. Belief in the importance of peer support and collaboration with families, communities, and other professionals, the power of hope and healing, redemption, and recovery. Building a responsive service delivery system that minimizes trauma is a never-ending task, but here are my 12 realistic suggestions towards the transformation of what we need. The nature of our work should be highly collaborative. In almost all cases, parents should know their children best. Let's support this belief with our resources. 3, every family is unique. Our support should be flexible and based on choice. 4, services and supports for families need to be accessible and preferably community-based. They should be driven by a relational style of customer service. We should develop more services and supports that are proactive in their approach to families, especially those that address the issues of economic insecurity and parental substance abuse and mental health disorders. Six, we should deliver more services that are recovery-based and encourage families to come back before a crisis occurs. Seven, our priority for our support and services should be given to those disenfranchised by racism, geographic isolation, and social class bias. Comprehensive service systems should be simplified and easier to access. Service delivery systems should produce measurable outcomes, and we should decrease our investment in services that lack any evidence of effectiveness. 10, we should improve our mechanisms for information sharing that achieves a balance between family privacy and the need for multiple systems to share data. 11, we should develop shared goals, procedures, and protocols for working with families who face a wide range of challenges. And 12, we should pay attention to the spiritual damage that has been done to children and families who have experienced significant levels of trauma. The ability to trust, to love, and to grow in, as individuals, and to function in a community with others. Finally, let me conclude by highlighting what is the most pressing issue facing Pennsylvania's county child welfare agencies, as well as their nonprofit agency partners. The number of vacancies and the shortage of staff in all these organizations is at crisis levels. Never in my 40-year career have I seen this many agencies struggling to find competent, committed, and qualified team members. I know of agencies that have absolutely no applicants in the queue while their organizations are facing a 50% vacancy rate. The few applicants who are stepping forward frequently lack the right training or background to perform the difficult tasks required of them. And because the situation is so critical within agencies, new employees are assigned caseloads almost immediately. The stress and the trauma of that added workload for an agency team member is significant, and the impact plays itself out every day in our interactions with children and families. The unhealthy level of staff turnover is destabilizing for all involved. No one is well cared for if the infrastructure for child safety is weak and inconsistent. We cannot expect best practice or high-quality services from team members who are barely able to keep up. Every exchange with a client becomes transactional with the family, not the relational approach that we so desperately need. This level of staff vacancy is unprecedented. It's not just about the low salaries or the difficult working conditions or COVID or the lack of focus in our field. It's the perfect storm of all of these factors and more. The resolution of the staff vacancy issue will only come after we have many courageous conversations and a commitment to change. I thank you again for the opportunity to share with you.
Paul, thank you so much for your testimony. As often happens, we're always short on time, so we're going to immediately go to our last commenter today, Sarah Klein with Gemma Services. She's joining us virtually, and we may have bought ourselves a few minutes. I do remember that when session is gaveled in at noon, which is very shortly, they are swearing in a new member. So we have a few minutes. So, Ms. Klein, if you'll proceed, and maybe if you can abbreviate some of your comments.
All right, good morning. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. On behalf of Gemma Services, thank you for providing this space to speak today. And thank you for being a part of this committee and the commitment to understanding the behavioral health and mental health and children youth systems. I'm grateful to have the opportunity to discuss the subject as I see as a root of so many of the conversations that you are having about adverse childhood experiences and trauma-informed care. Gemma Services provides multiple community-based programs, an approved private school, as well as our residential treatment program. Residential programs are the second highest level of care in Pennsylvania, only after psychiatric hospitalization, which is considered short-term and stabilization care. So that makes residential treatment the highest level of care for long-term mental health for children. As many of the speakers previous to me spoke about adverse childhood experiences, it should really cause alarm as how much it impacts a child's life. As you heard, it contributes to early death. The children served here at GEMMA Services in our residential program have all experienced a large number of adverse childhood experiences, as you'll hear in the stories I'm going to share with you. So as such, we at GEMMA approach our treatment of trauma and adverse childhood experiences as a life and death issue. Now, when you hear about residential treatment programs, you might have an image that comes to mind. And given what has been in the news recently about residential treatment, that image may not be a positive one. And as the speaker just spoke, there are multiple barriers that face not just residential treatment, but all mental health agencies right now, including staffing shortage, a lack of out-of-the-box thinking, outdated regulations, and a lack of funding. I could touch on many of these barriers, but as a program, we continue to focus on what we can do and providing the best care. I do want to pause and make note of the work that is done before a child comes to this level of care. Community-based and in-home mental health work needs to happen, and because that, as you heard, is addressing those child experiences as quickly as possible to give that child and that family a more chance of success. And as the mother of two and a professional in the field, I really would never wish a child to have to come and live in a residential treatment center 24 hours a day, usually for about up to a year. But children do, and children must. We do need this level of care. Because of the trauma that adults and the system have caused to children, they are led to have core beliefs that are demoralizing and life-threatening. Children that walk through our doors believe that no one loves them, that they are evil, that they deserve pain and suffering. And it should not be viewed as a failure that a child needs to come to a residential program. I certainly do not see it, and I would not have dedicated over a decade of working in a residential program because I know it can be life-changing for a child. The mission statement of our program specifically is a place for hope and transformative healing through holistic care. But how do we live into that mission? First, we really need to understand that a major aspect of treatment for a child is to re-experience, but in a safe place with a safe relationship, the events that hurt them. Traumatic memories are often replayed over and over again with the child seeking or expecting the same result, that same pain, or that same suffering. However, when the memory and event is not rewarded or not reinforced or is frankly not accurate, in that safe environment, such as a residential care, the memory of the event remains, but the feelings fade. As you read in my written testimony, I want to share a story about Elijah. Elijah came to our residential program almost 10 years ago at the age of 13. And if there ever was a clear example of a child who's endured adverse childhood experiences, it would be this young man. His father was unknown. His mother remained his legal guardian, but she was not equipped to have him return to her home upon discharge from our program. Elijah was conceived as the result of his mother being date raped. His mother had a long history of drug and alcohol that interfered with her ability to be a stable caregiver and likely suffered from her own traumas and mental health issues. At just 3 years old, Elijah was found wandering alone at night, which led to his first placement in foster care. Elijah was a child that no one truly wanted. Professionals wanted to make his life better and support him, but ultimately there was no one that truly wanted him. The relationships that I watched our staff form with him took a long time. His behaviors were a traumatic reenactment, pushed everyone away, including me at times. I'd like to share a story with you of one day when I got called to his unit and he was having a crisis. I found him outside. He had no clothes on. He was down on all fours. He was eating grass and mooing like a cow. Staff were simply standing there watching him because he actually wasn't doing anything unsafe, which is what we trained them to do. So I sat down beside him in the grass and not quite sure how that was going to go. I picked up a handful of grass and I handed it to him and I asked him if he wanted some more. That is trauma-informed care. I didn't try to get him to stop. I didn't even try to understand it in that moment. I simply saw a behavior that clearly he was displaying to keep people away from him. And I asked myself how to show him that he is safe and that I don't think he's bad. There's no book that's going to tell me that exact scenario and how to play it out because trauma symptoms don't have a playbook. Many sessions into his treatment, Elijah was starting to verbalize his trauma. He remembered being with the police at a young age, and he was very worried that this was going to have an impact on his next placement. I wasn't sure how he was correlating or what he meant by that. But finally, he had shared that no family was going to want him because of his criminal past. And I finally was able to connect the dots that Elijah believed when he was 3 years old, being picked up by the police, that he was a criminal and that he was bad. It never dawned on all the workers that worked with him and all the social workers that worked with him to explain to a three-year-old that he wasn't with the police because he was bad. So he believed for 10 years until he finally shared that thought with us, that he was able to learn that he's not true, and able to help him correct that belief about himself. So one of the tools that we use here in our program is what we call the insight generator. What do our staff do when a child is punching them, kicking them, spitting on them, trying to run away, making threats to hurt themselves, is standing outside naked eating grass? What do you think about that? How do you address that behavior? How do you teach that child to change their way of thinking, not just to not do those things, but to learn ways to deal with all the feelings that they're and the thoughts that they're having along with that? How do you relate that to trauma? Many of my new staff, when they first come here, they said, that child's punching me for a reason, but I don't understand how it's related to their trauma. How do you help correct the thought patterns that have developed for so long in children's head that their brains are rewired to believe that they are dangerous and safe? We use the insight generator to help answer those questions, to give our staff, our children, our families the answers how to manage those big emotions, how to tolerate their thoughts, and how to validate their feelings, to learn new ways to reframe their behaviors and thought patterns to create change. Which leads me to the second story that I want to share, Sierra. She came to our program when she was 9 years old with a history of physical aggression and severe self-harming behaviors. She had tied a cord around her neck and has tried to stab herself. She often, if not daily, expressed wanting to die. She lived with her mom and two younger siblings. Her biological father was not present in her life. Her stepfather sexually abused her for several years while she was in the mother's home. He would hold a knife to her and rape her. While there was a protection order against him, his stepfather remained close to the family by working across the street where they lived. She feared this man, and she would often draw horrific pictures of killing him. She frequently had nightmares and often would dissociate and relive her trauma. The assessments that we completed with her showed a high acuity of trauma responses, which allowed us to know where to start with her. It took several months to establish a trusting relationship with Sierra and a very intentional trauma-informed approach. For example, if a staff didn't have their ID badge on, she would get triggered. She would begin to scratch her arms. So we had to ensure that new staff were introduced by the staff that she already knew and trusted. If she was going to have a visit or if she was going to go on a doctor's appointment, she needed to be told in advance and assured who was going to be present with her, because she lived in fear of her stepfather showing up and taking her away. A key part to Sierra's treatment was actually the trauma work with her mother. Her mother had failed to protect her, and Sierra knew this. It was our job to help Sierra's mother clarify Sierra's past for her. We also had to help her mom understand that Sierra could both be upset, angry, and love her mom at the same time. The trauma work with mom also took time. We first needed to develop a relationship with her. And then we worked with her mom to write what we call a clarification letter. This is where the caretaker puts in writing that they were responsible for not keeping her safe. This letter gives the child who's been abused, like Sierra, permission to be angry about not being kept safe, but more importantly, the knowledge that they themselves are not to blame for their abuse. Once her mom was able to give her this gift, Sierra was able to start thinking it wasn't her fault, that she wasn't disgusting, and that she deserved to have a life worth living. The trauma work with Sierra and her mom took patience and a team willing to see her unsafe behaviors, not as setbacks, but for Sierra working through her trauma as a way to heal. Because healing from trauma for Sierra is going to be a lifetime of work. But in our program, her and her mother were able to make the first crucial steps towards that healing. I describe it to many of my staff like this. Imagine hurting your arm and your doctor prescribes you physical therapy for twice a week. You arrive and the physical therapist goes through their own assessments, begin to decide what exercises you have to complete to start to heal your arm. Now imagine if your physical therapist was only allowed to complete 4 exercises with you. Because of that injury that you have, you're only allowed those 4, and you must complete them again and again until you have mastered and healed your arm. But not all injuries are the same. Not all bodies are the same or have the same reaction. You want your physical therapist to know exactly your circumstances, your body's exact abilities, and be able to choose the exercises that will be tailored to you of what your injury, your body, and your treatment needs. You want to be able to change exercises when you develop mastery in one and approach a different one. That is trauma-informed care. Allowing mental health professionals, the children, and their families to take each trauma, each child, each family, each individual circumstance, and develop specific interventions to heal from their trauma. Which makes me want to share our last story about Anna. We've also used the Insight Generator with Anna, and it's really given her voice for traumatic experiences. At 12 years old, she had experienced the removal from her birth family, a death of a parent, parental addiction, physical abuse, emotional abuse, witnessing of a death, and multiple psychiatric hospitalizations. It was very slow for Anna to share the complexities of her trauma, even though she was getting the evidence-based practice of trauma-focused CBT. But the staff focused on interventions such as recognizing what unsafe meant to her, changing her environment for her to feel safe, seeing her behaviors as how she survived and not manipulative or bad, ensuring that she had contact with her family, ensuring she was told and reminded that she was cared for. And in addition, staff taught her specific emotional regulation skills such as grounding and correcting her unhelpful and untrue thoughts about herself. Anna is currently still in her program, and I was speaking with her just last week. She is being discharged back home right before Christmas. She was speaking about the school that she attends while she's in her program, and she joked she wasn't going to miss it at all. But she had a smile on her face and said to myself and her residential life manager, "Nah, I'm going to miss them a lot." She had formed such positive and trusting relationships with our staff here and both at her school, which is something she has never had before. She paused for a little while and simply looked at us and smiled and said she's going home. She was so proud of herself, and I don't believe she's had that feeling before. She is able to talk about her trauma and learning how to live with it and not just be defeated by it. Residential treatment is a place for hope, and the system does continue to view congregate care as the last hope at times, but we are still hope. We're asked to help transform a child and their family, typically after several less restrictive interventions have been tried, and both the parents or the children have experienced multiple adverse childhood experiences. The parents may or may not have had the opportunity to build resiliency or overcome with the many negative impacts that we all know can stem from ACEs. We're asked to heal trauma. We are now able to do this individually and holistically instead of through a one-size-fits-all approach. We need to be able to use the tools like Insight Generator, evidence-based practices, and truly out-of-the-box thinking to individualize treatment for children. We need the room and funds to allow children to get exactly what they individually need. We need families to be seen as the experts, and we, the mental health professionals, need to be given the resources and environment to support them with the individualized care they deserve. Funds need to be available to support these innovative tools that are embraced in so many other environments but often overlooked in behavioral and mental health systems. We want to work with the system to support it and not paralyze it. We succeed many, many more times than we fail, but publicly we are usually defined solely by our failures and not acknowledged for our successes. But residential treatment can prevent adverse experiences, and we can heal the ones that we've already experienced and stop the cycle of generational trauma by teaching children and their families how to heal when we're given the tools, resources, and freedom to do the work we have been charged to do. I want to thank you and grateful for this chance to share these stories of the hope and healing from our children.
Thank you, Sarah. Much appreciated. This has been a very helpful event this morning. Again, I want to thank Rep. Delosier for this opportunity, and most importantly, thank all of the presenters for the time that you took to share your experience and expertise with the Children and Youth Committee this morning. I'm hoping that this is the beginning of the conversation and that we will be continuing it and looking at policy. Rep. Delosier?
No, I agree wholeheartedly. Thank you for everybody that was willing to bring forward all different sides of it. Sarah, thank you for the case studies, truly understanding a lot of what came before you in the testimony, and then talking about the children that it affects directly. Thank you for what you did and what the folks at your center do on a regular basis and working with folks, we do need to make sure that we take a look at the public policy surrounding this and look for ways to keep our kids safe. That's our job as policymakers, to do that as much as possible. Thank you to everybody that does it on a daily basis, and we look forward to seeing where we have some gaps and where we can be helpful and be able to make sure some of the outdated regulations that came up, I know, were mentioned, you know, taking a look at what we don't need any longer and where we need to make some modifications. So thank you to everybody. And I'll say that we close out this meeting of the Children and Youth Committee, and thank everybody for being here. Thank you very much.